today I am joined by one of my amazing friends, Anastasia.
Hi guys.
You probably recognize her, we've done some amazing collabs in the past, but today I wanted to have her on my channel for an interview because I think it's about time that you guys get to know one of my most amazing and inspirational friends in this world. So let's get started. Your platforms and everything so we can get to know you a little bit better.
Sure, absolutely. Hi guys, I'm sure that a lot of you actually already seen me on Zoe's channel and all over social media. There are so many hats that I'm wearing. It's very hard to pinpoint one thing that I do. So I'm a fitness YouTuber, fitness influencer, fitness model slash a blogger. there's just a lot. And that's, I think, what makes our job so much fun.
Yeah.
Because it's never the same thing. We always do different things. Mm-hmm. And of course, a big part of what I do is personal training. I work with girls from all over the world and help them to get in the best shape of their lives. And of course, this is one of my favorite parts about the job. And inspire girls, again, from all over how to live a healthy, balanced lifestyle. And I'm not only talking, of course, about fitness. I'm just talking in general about being positive, believing in yourself, and going for your biggest dreams and inspirations.
Yes, so Anastasia is one of my best friends, and she has a truly inspirational story, but I don't think that a lot of you out there know it, so that's why I wanted to take today to interview her and allow her the opportunity to share her inspirational past and give you guys some motivation to go out there and pursue your dreams and goals, because you've really come a long way and built such an empire for yourself. It's so much to be proud of, and I'm so proud of you. So let's get started and talk about where you're from and where you were born and raised.
Sure. So originally I was born in a town that most of you guys will not even be able to see on the maps. Like, I'm not joking. It's just, you cannot locate this. It's tiny, tiny town in also a place that doesn't even no longer exist, Soviet Union. So I was born in Soviet Union, which is now Ukraine, in a tiny small town called Krasny Luch, which is almost on the border between Russia and Ukraine. I lived there until 16, and then I moved to the US by myself, without family, friends, relatives, no one. So it was me, myself, and I, pretty much starting 16.
Wow, was that obviously very scary for you? Was it difficult, or was it exciting? Like, what were the types of emotions that you kind of went through in that chapter?
It was definitely not exciting.
Yeah, I can imagine. Did you have an English language already, like, down, or would you say that that was something you had to learn and get used to speaking?
So, I knew English already, but not to the point of going to American high school. I had a good conversational English, but it was nothing like Rita's Scarlet Letter.
Did you read it, by the way?
No, I haven't.
Yeah. Another thing that was interesting is that I actually studied British English, and then I came to the US, and out of all the states, I happened to be in one of the southern states, North Carolina. I was placed, actually, it's interesting because I came to the counselor and I said, here's my transcript, here's all the classes I take. In Ukraine, I just graduated from the ninth grade, and he looks at all the transcripts and he says, Oh, well, you took so many credits, would you like to graduate this year? So I jumped from the ninth grade straight to the 12th. And I was actually the youngest senior ever graduate at high school.
I didn't know this about her, so this is really exciting. Wow.
Yeah, but I was like a kid with all the adults. That's how, yeah, I felt, because everyone was so much older than I am. And here I am sitting, not understanding a word, guys. Like, first few months in the school. Oh, and not only that, they also placed me in all the honor classes. So I'm sitting there, just looking and trying to understand the teacher. And it just, the southern accent to me, just felt like everyone just, instead of separate words, just one word was like one sentence. Like, I couldn't understand anything.
Yeah.
And it was so tough. Like, I would just come home from school and I would spend, I don't even know, 8-9 hours just doing homework, because I had to go back and go through vocabulary, read everything, understand everything. I mean, it was really, really tough. But I think what made it the toughest is just being without the family.
Yeah.
I don't know if some of you actually witnessed that time, but that was the time when Skype did not exist. That was the time when WhatsApp didn't exist. That was the time when AOL was its thing, and that's when the phone cards were costing a fortune. And I talked to my family once a week, probably for 10 minutes. So wow. I would save all the minutes and just put them towards calling them. And for my grandparents, I still wrote letters to them from the hand. And I would send it to them, they would send it to me, and from the US to Ukraine, it would take about like 3 weeks. Wow. And I would like wait by the, you know, for the postman to come over and hope that there's like a letter from me, from my friends or from my grandparents. So it was mentally the most difficult thing I've done, honestly, to this day, probably, is just at 16 saying goodbye to the life as you know it.
Yeah.
You know, to your culture, to your language, to your family, to your friends, to the lifestyle that you had, to your dog, who was my son, it was my child, and just saying goodbye forever.
Yeah.
And I know I can say and talk about it all this with a smile now, because that was the best experience. And honestly, that taught me that taking chances in life is everything, because life will always reward you every single time. But back then, it felt terrible. It was the most difficult thing I've ever done.
Yeah.
And I think the biggest and the most scariest moment, and I talked about it during one of the interviews here in Italy, is that I was standing at the airport and it was cold, dark Ukrainian winter day, morning, and they already started boarding the plane, and my dad was there. And he's like, okay, gots to go. Because he's, you know, one of those tough Ukrainian men who never shows his feelings, you know. And he was treating me like, you know, like a man, like, okay, get on that plane, get yourself together. And I was just standing there, Zoe, like everything inside me was like, I can't.
Yeah,
like I can't. Tears running down my whole face, you know. It was brutal. And they literally said like, okay, last call for, you know, for, I think it was like Raleigh, North Carolina. And he's like, if you're not leaving in 5 seconds, I'm just gonna rip that ticket, just like tear it apart, and you'll never have this chance again.
So was moving to America your decision, or was it a family type of decision?
It was for sure a family decision. But
okay.
They, in a sense, okay, so they did it smart way. Because we're going to talk about, you know, the luxury and how, you know, having this abundant lifestyle was always a big deal for me, even when I was young. So they kind of went through that thing like, okay, Anastasia, well, if you want to have the life that you want, you know, you can't depend on anyone but yourself.
Yeah.
And the only way for you to do it is for you to go and get it. So if you're staying here in Ukraine, you know the opportunities you have here. So if you're not going to go, then you will never have what you want.
Wow.
Because no one is going to create it for you. So that's why, in the, you know, I went for it, and I'm so grateful that they did it this way. But back then it sounded like just, like tearing you apart, because you want your family near, you want that lifestyle, your friends, everything. And then from another thing, it's like that bigger purpose,
yeah,
know, that you have. It's like in the long run, but you can still like, you still can't feel it, smell it, touch it, but you know that that's the life that you want.
Yeah, you know it needs to be pursued.
Exactly.
So Anastasia now lives in Rome with me in Roma, so she's my Roma family.
Yeah. How do you call the souls? sisters.
Soul sisters.
We're soul sisters.
Yeah, Roman soul sisters, because we both share this amazing love for Rome. So how did you eventually go from Ukraine, America, then living in Rome, Italy? Like, yeah. What was the draw? Why Rome? I know that you love Rome and why, but I think that this will also inspire others to hear about how long you pursued this dream of being able to say that you live in Rome.
Yeah, so what happened is after high school, I got a full scholarship to the American University. And the university, even the university professor described it was in the middle of nowhere. It was an amazing private university. I think, God, I don't wanna say the wrong number, but I think it was like 800 students in the whole university. So it was super private. I mean, we had like at most 15 students per class. Mm-hmm. So it was, but it was great because, I mean, the education was excellent. But again, as I said, it was in the middle of nowhere. So I'm the type of a person, because I went already through that experience of, you know, leaving Ukraine, going to the US. Again, it got easier to doing it.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
Because the more you practice it, guys, I feel like the more then it just becomes natural.
Exactly. The more you step outside of your comfort zone and step into foreign places.
Absolutely.
Then honestly, the easier and easier it becomes, especially with solo travel as well. All other things become a lot more easier as your independence grows and you've pushed yourself to expand that and expand the horizons of your life.
Exactly. And you're so right, Zoe. And that's why I always encourage people to really step out of the comfort zone. And I know the first few times it's just going to really suck. It's just going to take everything out of you, especially if you've never done it before. I mean, it's going to be tough. I mean, as I mentioned that story when, you know, my dad like was ripping that ticket, I just grabbed it and I started running. I mean, I didn't even, I just never turned back. I cried my eyes out. The most difficult day in my life, but I took that ticket, you know? It was like my ticket to the next stage of my life. So once I've done it, it was easier. And then I think it was my second year in college, and I started thinking about, I think our international house was started talking about the exchange programs.
Okay.
And they said, hey, who would like to do an exchange program? And I was like,
yeah.
Get me out of here.
Yeah.
Get me out of here. I can't see on Charlie's another day. KFC is no longer calling my name. I can't do this. So they said, we have two exchange programs, one to Paris, one to Rome. Mm-hmm. And which one would you like? And I've never been to any of the places, guys. I mean, for me, you know, a girl from Ukraine, first of all, when I was growing up, the borders were completely closed. So you couldn't even go anywhere, even if you wanted to. I didn't speak neither languages. I didn't speak at that time. I didn't speak Italian, didn't speak French. So it was kind of like the decision it was a very random decision. It was just like tomatoes, tomatoes. I don't know. I've never been to both places. I don't speak the language. I don't know what to choose. And, it was just like, okay, let's do Rome. I think it's because of all the influence. When I was growing up, I was used to watching a lot of Italian movies. It was like a big deal. So in Eastern Europe. So that's why I was like, okay, well, you know what? Let's go. I know Adriano Celentano. I've heard him sing it before. Yeah. He sounds pretty good Italian. Like, you're just beautiful. Let's go for that, for Italy. So that's pretty much how I happened to be in Rome. It was very random. Again, it wasn't anything because I didn't speak it.
Yeah. And then when you did go to Rome, you fell in love with it.
And then something happened. I love US. US is a great country, and it honestly gave me so many opportunities. And, you know, I'm a US citizen now, and I'm like, my heart is forever filled, to the US for everything that this country has done for me. But it never felt like home.
Yeah.
And when my plane, I still remember it, Zoe, and I know you can relate to it so well. When my plane landed at the Fiumicino airport, and then, you know, I don't even remember, I think I took like a metro to get to Rome. I had no idea what's going on, all the foreign languages.
Yeah.
But I was excited. That was exciting.
Yeah.
And that's how I knew this is good. Because I didn't feel that same feeling when I was moving to the US. But that was exciting when I was moving to Rome. I was like, yay! when I just, I still remember it as, so when I just first realized that I'm in Rome, I was dragging this like huge bag with all my stuff across Campo dei Fiori, which is one of the piazzas, and I'm sure you, yeah, you know, you filmed so many times there, I'm sure you guys, your audience, seen it. And I just remember just dragging it through the piazza, and I was like, oh my god, like this is paradise, this is the most incredible place in the world. Yeah. And I can't explain to you guys exactly what it was. It was just, I keep saying it's the vibe,
yeah,
right?
It really,
like,
really
you
is.
Have to be there to really understand what Rome is. It just, yeah, you can't explain it. Of course, you can see the pictures, you know, you can see the videos, we can show you the food, but it's just
yeah,
how you feel when you're there.
It's and a feeling. Rome is just a feeling in itself.
Yeah.
And so you went to school there for how many years? Or?
So I went to school there, I think it was like a year and a half.
Okay.
And, well, I was supposed to go only for one semester, and then I was like, oh.
Yeah.
I'm gonna milk that cow for as long as I can. Is that an expression?
Yeah.
I'm so random when it comes to those things. I was like, okay, how can I stay? I decided that I'm going to stay another semester. But to stay another semester, that's the funniest thing. Of course, I had to get a job.
Yeah.
That was the condition. After 3 months, yeah, about 3-4 months of learning Italian, I had to get a job. And it was tough, guys. I'm not going to lie, because I only spoke the language for 4 months. And I know I'm saying it with a smile right now, because it was, again, one of those experiences that I'm so grateful for.
Yeah.
But it was not fun.
So what was the job?
So, first, I was a running guide all around Rome.
Mm-hmm.
So I would run with affluent clients and tell them about Rome. So they work out and at the same time learn the history of Rome.
Oh, okay.
So I did that for some time, which, you know, for me that was ideal because I love fitness so
yeah.
much. That was like, oh my god, like what are we talking about? I can see Rome every day
yeah.
and work out. Like, yay.
Yeah.
So that was my first job, and then my second job, because of the hours, because I was still attending university hours, and so I just mm-hmm. it was conflicting with my hours, so I decided I'm going to do waitressing during the evening.
Okay.
The days when I'm not, you know, when I can come back from the university.
Yeah.
And I still remember I wrote down, like, I didn't know how to ask even if I can get a job.
Yeah.
So I would walk from one bar to another, one restaurant to another, and I would just ask them, like, do you need help? I'm not joking, like every day I would wake up, well, I would go to school and then I would go and look for a job. And I would like cover so many bars and restaurants, but I think because my English, I mean Italian was so limited.
They're like, no, no, thank you, no.
But you know what, guys? Again, it's that mentality, like never give up.
Yeah.
Like, ever, 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 period.
Yeah.
Like, and no, never existed, like, in my vocabulary. Like, no, and I'm like, okay.
Yeah, okay. Just kept going.
Just keep going. Just keep going. Eventually someone will say yes, I promise. And, yeah, so I walked in into the bar in Campo dei Fiori. It's actually still there.
Yeah.
I still have a t-shirt from them. I was kind of like, do we want, would you like some help? I don't remember what I said in Italian. I was like, okay, this is going to be another no. He's like, when can you start? I was like,
perfect.
Oh my god, I was like, tonight, I can do it, I can start at 4. He's like, okay, at 4, see you there. I was like, oh my god,
yeah.
I just got a job. It was like, probably, like, I don't even remember, guys, honestly, it was like 4 euros per hour.
Yeah.
But I got it, I was so excited. I got to, you know, to stay in Italy, I was ready to do whatever, I didn't care. The job was super difficult, though.
Yeah.
I worked from 4:30, I still remember it, from 4:30 in the afternoon until 2:30 in the morning.
Wow.
And then I would sleep for like 4 hours and then get up and go to the university. Okay. And then I would do my homework and then rinse and repeat.
Yeah. Wow. And then you left Rome for how many years until you made your return?
And then
this is the good part.
Well, it is the good part. It wasn't a good part for me. First of all, I was leaving Rome.
Yeah.
And second, the amount of years that it took me to come back. 12 years, guys.
She pursued Rome for 12 years.
Yeah.
I think it's just amazing. Yeah.
12 years.
Yeah.
Talking about perseverance, guys, and talking about like true love. I like have goosebumps because I love it so much. The city is like everything. I never had a moment, I never had a day, I never had an hour when I was like, during this 12 years, and I was like, well, you know what, maybe I should just give up on my dream, or maybe it's too unattainable, or maybe I should settle down, like, you know, like a lot of people do, and it's unfortunate, because I always say, don't ever settle down, ever, because that will, you will always, you will, nothing will ever feel that way.
Exactly.
Nothing
will always have the what if, the wondering. So when you said that you thought about Rome every day, would you say it was like a visualization?
Absolutely. It was everything. It was everything. So this is what I've done. I pretty much every day I would drive to work, and I was still working at corporate at that time. And I would just imagine traffic in Rome. I still remember it.
Yeah.
And I know I love it. Like people, Italians are so passionate. They get so like upset.
Yeah.
Like cuts them or beeps at them.
Yeah.
And I love it too. Like other people don't understand it, but like for Zoe and I, it's like the most fascinating thing in the world.
Yeah, I see the best bus going ever. It's just, I don't know. It's just that whole feeling of Rome. Every little piece of Rome makes it this whole big vibration, I guess. This whole big feeling of just this huge city that's so ancient, yet it's a metropolis, and you see cars like driving beside the Colosseum, something that is just so incredibly old and historic and amazing. And it's just honestly, our favorite thing to talk about is like Rome and the love attraction.
So we're talking about other things, but
yeah.
But that's our favorite.
Yeah, that's our favorite things to talk about. All right, guys, so before we get into more of this chit chat about the whole visualization and manifesting, moving to your dream city, fully manifesting for 12 years to reach this amazing goal, I'm going to have another interview with Anastasia, part two, if you will, all about manifesting luxury and your dream life, because you have done amazing, amazing things, and Anastasia has helped me to understand the law of attraction better in so many ways and manifest so many incredible things. Such, for example, this villa in Italy, which is over 400 years old, that we just got invited to stay at for a week just because. So we manifested this, and we'll get into more details, but I'm going to leave that for another interview. So stay tuned, and Anastasia, thank you so much for coming on my channel.
I loved it.
Yeah, I'm so excited to introduce you guys more to her, as her story is amazing and inspiring, and I'm sure you're already amazed and inspired so far. So have an amazing day, and I'll be sure to link all of Anastasia's social links below. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button if you haven't yet, and give this video a thumbs up, and we'll see you very soon. Ciao!